This presentation gives a brief overview of Iwan modeling for structures with bolted joints. Our goal is to predict the response of a structure such as this jet engine, but the response of the assembly is affected by all of the discrete joints, and each joint might be influenced by microscale asperity contacts in the joint regions, and those could even be governed by atomic and chemical interactions at the surfaces. The thing that's peculiar about all this, though, is when we look at the built-up structure and we compute its response, for example, this figure shows the response as a function of frequency of this structure with two beams held together by a bolted joint, and what we tend to see is that the response is quite linear, or it has the look of a linear system. We might see small variations of the frequency and damping as the force level changes, as we see in this picture here when we zoom in, but the response is mostly linear. And we'll exploit that to use a quasi-modal model approach for these types of structures. So this presentation will talk about discrete joints. We'll talk about how we can represent a structure as an assembly of modes that are uncoupled. And then we'll look at several different test cases and see how well this modal approach works. For many years, we've known that if we build a structure out of a solid piece of metal, that we'll be able to predict it quite effectively using finite element codes, and that the response will have very low damping. Most real structures, though, are built out of assemblies where we hold pieces together with joints, and those joints involve friction and contact at the interfaces. And not only does that make it more challenging to predict the natural frequencies of the structure, but we get significant damping from those interfaces, which can be beneficial, though it's hard to predict and hard to know whether we can rely on it. Now, damping can be classified in two different regions, and the kind that we are most interested in is microslip. A bolted joint is clamped together, and that clamping force provides a region that always stays stuck. However, when we load the joint, we see that at the edges of the contact, we get a little bit of slip as a portion of the contact interface comes unstuck. Now, macroslip is what would occur if we applied a large force and the joint slips completely. And while this is important in some applications, typically we design our structures with clamping forces that are large enough to prevent the joint from going into macroslip. The simplest contact model that we can come up with is a Jenkins element, which can describe stick slip behavior. So consider a frictional contact with some normal load holding these two surfaces together. And if we apply a force, you can imagine that for small forces, the joint stays stuck and we have a linear response. And for larger forces, we can pull this slider loose, and we see the force saturate. One approach that's been popular in the literature for modeling joints is to take the contact interface and apply a large number of sliders distributed over the interface. We could use a contact solution to determine what the contact pressure is or what the normal force is for each of these sliders, and actually try to predict the microslip and macroslip of the joint as a function of load. So this is an amazing approach because it does allow us to predict what will happen. The disadvantage is that each joint requires many degrees of freedom, and we'll see later that we can't necessarily guarantee that we'll get the kind of behavior out of this model that we observe experimentally. The Iwan model is an alternative where we model the entire joint with a collection of sliders, but we'll see that we choose those sliders in a different way. They aren't actually distributed physically in space. Imagine that we have this collection of sliders and each one has a different strength. If we apply a small load, we can get microslip, where some of the sliders slip and the others remain stuck. A larger load will give macroslip, where every one of the sliders breaks free. And an Iwan model is just an arrangement of sliders in parallel like this, but we choose the strength of the sliders to follow a certain distribution. We call that the population density. And this distribution is chosen to match what's been observed experimentally in tests on structures with joints. So this is the population density in Siegelman's four-parameter Iwan joint. And we'll see that it has some neat properties. The population density is governed by four parameters that we see here. And usually it's convenient to convert those to four parameters that are more physically meaningful. And then we can think about the stiffness and the dissipation of the joint versus amplitude. First of all, the parameter KT governs the stiffness of the joint as we transition from microslip to macroslip. FS is the slip force, or the force at which the joint transitions. And chi and beta govern the damping behavior. Chi is the slope of the power law, energy dissipation versus amplitude, and beta controls the transition from microslip to macroslip and the level of microslip dissipation that we have in the system. So this model was based on a large number of experiments performed at Sandia Labs and performed in the literature on classical systems such as Hertzian contact. We know that this model can describe the dissipation versus force behavior that a lot of those models have shown. In summary, the Iwan model gives a single model that captures behavior that's observed both analytically and experimentally. If we think about this model as applying to a one degree of freedom system, we can actually define the system level damping. We can derive this from the energy dissipated per cycle, which for a single degree of freedom system is given by this expression. And then we can use the standard definitions for damping ratio, essentially linearizing over one cycle of the response in a free decay, for example. And we can use that then to define the damping ratio as a function of energy dissipated per cycle. And given a measurement of the velocity amplitude versus time, we can compute the damping ratio from experimental data as well. Now, this model is convenient because if the structure is linear and we plot damping ratio versus force, we'll see a constant damping, and that's our typical linear structure. Power law behavior will manifest itself as a slope of 1 plus chi in the microslip regime, and we can also see macroslip behavior. And so we'll see several examples of this in a minute. This model is excellent, and we can use this to model discrete joints in a structure. However, if we have many joints, each one of those joints will require a separate joint model. We'll need many parameters to characterize them. And it becomes cumbersome computationally as well, having to track all of these different joints. If we think about a global deformation of the structure, though, a modal response, remember the structure is approximately linear, so it might be convenient to think of this structure in terms of a set of modes and to model each one of those modes with a one degree of freedom system oscillator that has an Iwan joint to provide joint-like nonlinearity. In other words, if we think of taking this structure, which is nonlinear, we can apply a modal transformation, and we'd obtain a model kind of like this, where we have the linear modal terms, external forcing, and then the joint force from all of the discrete joints projected onto each of the modes. And again, if we're in the microslip regime, this will be approximately linear. And there's some excellent theory that explains why this type of model can be well represented as a set of uncoupled modes. We also have increasing experimental evidence that this model works in practice, and I'll discuss that later. Let's start with a very simple example just involving a mass spring system. And the goal then will be to replace this 3 degree of freedom system with three uncoupled modal models, each with joint-like behavior. We'll perform a simulation on the system with discrete Iwan joints, apply an impact force, convert the response of the structure to modal coordinates, use a Hilbert transform to estimate frequency versus amplitude and damping versus amplitude, and then we'll match that to an analytical one degree of freedom model where we have a modal simulation and modal Iwan parameters. We can use the same approach, this one degree of freedom system. We can generate its response, use a Hilbert transform to get frequency and damping versus amplitude, and we optimize until those match. A few words on the Hilbert transform. Given a velocity signal, and this gray curve here is a oscillating velocity response of a structure, given that measurement, the Hilbert transform gives us the amplitude and the phase versus time. We can fit that to a polynomial or spline model to smooth it so that we can then differentiate and obtain the frequency in damping versus time. So this slide summarizes how well this works for the first mode. So the black circles are the response of the truth model, the 3-degree of freedom system, modal filtered to only include the first mode. The red circles are the modal response of a 1-degree of freedom system whose parameters are tuned to best match the response of this mode. And the blue line is an analytical model derived in Siegelman's paper that describes frequency in dissipation versus amplitude. And you can see that the modal model matches the discrete model amazingly well, and that the analytical equations work well in microslip and macroslip, but don't work very well in the transition region as we'd expect. We can also look at modes 2 and 3, and we see similar behavior. Again, the modal model works very well. Now, as I said before, it's convenient to, instead of plotting modal energy dissipation versus force, to plot damping ratio, equivalent damping ratio versus modal amplitude. And so this lower figure shows the preferred plot. This is easier to generate. And in this figure, it's very clear to see that the damping tends toward the material damping, which we said is 10 to the minus 4 in these simulations. It shows a power law behavior in this region. And then we go into macroslip and see the macroslip behavior at high forces or high amplitudes. Now, there is a catch to these types of simulations. Everything that you've seen so far involved a modal force, or in other words, we applied one force to the structure that would excite only mode 2, in this case, in the linear structure, or mode 1, in this case, and then we modal filtered to include only mode 1. In practice, though, we apply a force, say, to one of the individual masses or to a discrete point on a structure, and that force will excite all modes simultaneously. So this figure shows the response when we excite at three different points, modal filtered to include only mode 1 again. And the response shows some scatter, or in other words, the modes that we've neglected, the modes other than mode 1, do enter in a little bit and contaminate the response. But still, this is an outstanding model and can be used, has pretty good fidelity anyway. We can see still the power law behavior that we expect, and we can see the damping decay down to the low-level material damping at low force levels. As we look at some of the other modes, the deviation can be worse. That can partially be explained by the fact that if we looked at the amplitude of mode 2, we would see that it's much smaller than mode 1. And so we'd expect some of the force from mode 1 to bleed into the response of this mode. In any event, there is a region of microslip where this model still might work fairly well for mode 2. And it's certainly better than using a linear model, which would have constant damping. So, we've shown how this works for a simple spring mass system. What about a more realistic structure, such as a finite element model with two beams bolted together? The procedure was the same as we used before. And we take this finite element model and apply discrete Iwan joints between each of the bolted interfaces in the structure. And to simplify the model, we're treating those as square patches, so we can use a coarser mesh. Each patch is connected to a single point, and then that point is connected between top beam and bottom beam using discrete Iwan model. So we have four Iwan models, four joints, and we'll see how the response of this structure compares to a modal Iwan equivalent. Again, we see that it works amazingly well. One modal Iwan model, the analytical model in red fits the discrete simulation data in black very well. And here in this system, we see over an order of magnitude increase in damping. in this microslip region. Now this structure would again have the same limitations that we saw in the previous case, and you can see our paper for more detail on that. If we look at the other modes, we see similar behavior, so the modal approach is working really well for this structure. Think of what we have now. We've taken a finite element model that has potentially many, many degrees of freedom and several discrete joints, and we've now fit that to a modal response, three uncoupled modes, or however many uncoupled modes we might find. And each of those modes is governed by a 1 degree of freedom system. So if we want to predict the response, all we need to do is integrate 1 degree of freedom equations of motion. So here's an example of integrating the equation of motion for each of the three modes of a structure. We can then add those up and predict at any point on the structure the response. So this is a powerful approach, and the computational savings can be very significant. Let's see how this works on real laboratory data. So a similar structure was constructed. It has four bolted joints, torqued to a certain level, and then a laser vibrometer was used to test the structure. So we hung it from bungee cords to simulate free conditions, applied forcing using an automatic hammer, and then modal filtered the responses to obtain the modal damping behavior. Here's another picture of Brandon with the experimental setup so you can get an idea of the scale. And you can see the lasers that were used, a single point laser that remained stationary, and then a scanning laser to test at a grid of points over the beams. The approach was similar. We'll apply an impact force, convert the response into modal coordinates, and use a Hilbert transform, and then find a modal model that reproduces the same modal response. Now here, because the structure is excited at one point, the responses had to be filtered to isolate each mode. So we used a bandpass filter to isolate one mode. The red curves are all the different velocity responses at different points on the structure. And we can take all of those, divide by the mode shape at each point on the structure to estimate modal amplitude for each of the modes. We'll focus on only the first three modes, and then those were averaged and fit to a modal Iwan model. And what we found is that we got excellent results. However, at low force amplitude, the power law slope ended up going at a slope of 2, or in other words, linear. We thought of that and recognized that probably our system actually might have some linear damping that ends up dominating at low forces. So we simply added a viscous damper to the model, and then we're able to predict the whole range of microslip behavior from low levels up to high level. We've also done this on some more realistic structures. This is an assembly of automotive catalytic converters. Using very low force levels, we could estimate the linear damping and estimate the mode shapes of each of the modes. And then we looked at larger force levels to see which modes might behave nonlinearly. The modal response, modal damping ratio versus amplitude obtained from that catalytic converter system due to input forces at many different points and at various force levels. And all of these curves collapse onto one damping versus amplitude curve. Or in other words, this suggests that we could model this structure using uncoupled modal model. And with relatively small error, we could approximate the response using a modal Iwan model and with linear damping down at very low force levels. This part here is just an artifact of Hilbert transform and noise as the response gets very small. Now you can do this too with the MATLAB tools that we've provided. There's an M file that includes all of the procedure that we've outlined, loading a measurement, bandpass filtering, applying a Hilbert transform to obtain the magnitude and phase versus time. From those, we can fit a spline and obtain frequency and damping versus amplitude, and we can fit a modal Iwan model if we want to obtain a 1 degree of freedom model for the structure. So in conclusion, we've seen that modal Iwan models can represent real structures very accurately. Now, we do have to watch out for exceptions, but for the most part, this can be a very powerful model. And considering how much simpler this is, how much easier the system identification becomes, it's a powerful model to exploit whenever it could be applicable.